Penguin Audio presents The Navigator by Clive Cussler with Paul Kemprecos. Read by Scott Brick. Prologue. A far-off land, about 900 BC. The monster emerged from the morning mists in the pearly light of dawn. The massive head, with its long snout and flaring nostrils, advanced toward shore where the hunter knelt, bowstring taut to his cheek, eyes focused on a deer grazing in the marsh. A rippling sound caught his ear, and he glanced out at the water. He uttered a fearful moan, threw the bow aside, and leaped to his feet. The startled deer disappeared into the woods, with the terrified hunter close on its tail. The tendrils of fog parted to reveal a giant sailing ship. The vessel's 200-foot-long wooden hull of reddish-brown was fringed with curtains of seaweed. A man stood on the ship's upswept stem, behind the carved figurehead of a snorting stallion. He had been gazing into a small wooden box. As the ghostly shoreline materialized, the man raised his head and pointed to the left. The helmsman at the twin steering oars brought the ship around in a graceful turn that sent it on a new course parallel to the densely wooded shoreline. Deckhands expertly adjusted the vertically striped red and white square sail to compensate for the change in direction. The captain was in his mid-twenties, but the serious expression on his handsome face added years to his appearance. His strong nose was curved slightly at the bridge. His thick black beard was arranged in rows around a full mouth and square jaw. Sun and sea had darkened his skin mahogany. The unfathomable eyes that scanned the shoreline were so deep a brown that the pupils were almost invisible. The captain's high station in life entitled him to wear a purple robe dyed with the valuable extract from the murex snail. He preferred to go bare-chested and wore the cotton kilt of an ordinary crewman. A floppy, conical-knit cap covered the close-cropped, wavy black hair. A pendant hung from a gold chain around his neck. The briny smell of the sea had faded as the ship left the open ocean and entered the wide bay. The captain filled his lungs with air that was redolent with the scent of flowers and green-growing things. He savored the prospect of fresh water and ached to set foot on dry land. Although the voyage was long, it had gone well, thanks to the hand-picked Phoenician crew. All seasoned, deep-water mariners. The crew included a scattering of Egyptians and Libyans and others from the countries bordering the Mediterranean. A contingent of Scythian marines provided security. The Phoenicians were the finest seamen in the world, adventurous explorers and traders whose maritime empire extended throughout the Mediterranean and beyond the Pillars of Hercules and the Red Sea. Unlike the Greeks and the Egyptians, whose ships hugged the shore and dropped anchor when the sun set, the fearless Phoenicians sailed day and night, out of sight of land. With a fair wind from astern, their big trading ships could cover more than 100 miles a day. The captain was not Phoenician by birth, but he was well versed in the sea arts. His command of navigation and seamanship, and his cool judgment during bouts of bad weather, had quickly gained the crew's respect. The vessel under the captain's command was a ship of Tarshish, built specifically for long-range commerce on the open ocean. Unlike the tubby short-haul traders, the vessel's lines were long and straight. The deck and hull timbers were hewn from tough Lebanese cedar, and the thick mast was low and strong. The square Egyptian linen sail, quilted with leather belts for strength, was the most efficient deep-water sailing rig in existence. The curved keel and upswept stem and stern presaged the Viking ships, which would not be built until centuries later. The secret behind Phoenician mastery of the sea went beyond technology. Organization aboard their ships was legendary. Each crewman knew his place in the well-oiled machinery that was a Phoenician sea venture. Rigging was neatly stowed in an easily accessible room that was the responsibility of the captain's assistant. The lookout man knew the location of each piece of tackle and constantly tested the ship's rigging to make sure it would work if needed in an emergency. The captain felt something soft brush against his bare leg. Allowing himself a rare smile, he set the wooden box in a receptacle and reached down and picked up the ship's cat. Phoenician cats had their origins in Egypt, where the animals were worshipped as gods. Phoenician ships carried cats as trade items and for rat control. The captain stroked the orange-yellow-striped cat a few times, then gently set the purring feline back down on the deck. The ship was approaching the wide mouth of a river. The captain called out a command to the lookout man. "Prepare the riggers to drop sail and alert the oarsmen." The lookout man relayed the first command to a pair of crewmen who scrambled like monkeys up the mast to the yardarm. Two other sailors tossed lines attached to the lower corners of the sail to the riggers, who used the ropes to reef the big linen square. Brawny armed rowers arranged in two ranks of 20 were already at their benches. Unlike the slave rowers on many vessels, the oarsmen who powered the ship forward with quick, precise strokes were trained professionals. The helmsman steered the ship into the river. Although the river was swollen with spring runoff from snow melting in the hills and mountains, its shallow waters and rapids would prevent the ship from moving farther upstream. The Scythian mercenaries stood along the ship's rail, weapons at the ready. The captain stood on the prow, surveying the riverbank. He saw a grassy promontory that projected into the river and ordered the oarsmen to hold the ship against the current while the deck crew dropped anchor. A muscular man with prominent cheekbones and a face as weathered as old saddle leather strode up to the captain. Tarsa commanded the Scythian marines who protected the ship and its cargo. Related to the Mongols, the Scythians were known for their skill as horsemen and bowmen, and for their peculiar habits. In battle, they drank the blood of their vanquished enemies and took scalps that they used as napkins. Tarsa and his men painted their bodies red and blue, cleansed themselves with vapor baths, and wore leather shirts and trousers tucked into soft leather boots. Even the poorest Scythian adorned his clothes with gold ornaments. Tarsa wore a small horse pendant that the captain had given him. "I'll organize a scouting party to go ashore," Tarsa said. The captain nodded. "I'm going with you." A smile came to the Scythian's stony face. As a landsman, he had little faith at first in the young captain's ability to keep the ship afloat. But he had watched the captain command the massive ship and had seen that there was iron behind the young man's patrician features and soft-spoken manner. The wide-bodied utility boat normally towed behind the ship was brought alongside. The Scythian and three of his toughest fighters got into the boat with the captain and two strong rowers. Minutes later, the boat bumped against the promontory with a hard, grating sound. Under the grass overgrowth was a stone quay. The captain tied the boat up to a bollard that was all but hidden by weeds. Tarsa ordered one man to stay with the rowers. Then he set off with the captain and the other Scythians along the overgrown stone-paved road that ran inland from the quay. After weeks spent on a rocking deck, they walked with an unsteady gait, but quickly recovered their land legs. A few hundred feet from the river, they encountered a weed-choked central plaza lined on all four sides by dilapidated buildings. Tall grass grew in the open doorways and alleys. The captain pictured the settlement as it was on his first visit. The plaza had been bustling with activity. Hundreds of workers had occupied the flat-roofed dormitories and toiled in the warehouses. The landing party methodically searched every building. Satisfied that the settlement was deserted, the captain led the way back to the river. He walked to the end of the pier and waved. As the crew hauled anchor and the rowers powered the ship toward the quay, the captain turned to the Scythian commander. Are your men ready for the important task that lies ahead? The question brought a snort from the Scythian. My men are ready for anything. The captain was unsurprised at the answer. He had spent many hours talking to Tarsa during the long voyage. The captain's unquenchable thirst for knowledge about people of all races had led him to question Tarsa about his homeland and people, and he had come to like the tough old warrior in spite of his blue and red skin and his odd habits. The ship tied up to the quay, and the crew lowered a wide gangplank. Hooves pounded on the deck as two draft horses were led from their stable beneath the stern and down the ramp. The animals were nervous about being out in the open, but the Scythians quickly calmed them with soft words and handfuls of honey-soaked grain. The captain organized a work party to take on fresh water and any food that could be found. Then he descended into the hold and stood next to a crate made out of sturdy Lebanese cedar. The container seemed to glow in the light streaming through the deck hatch. He called up to the crew to use great care in hoisting it from the hold. Thick ropes were attached to the crate and affixed to the boom hook. The boom creaked under the heavy weight, and the crate was lifted slowly from the hold and lowered onto the deck. The hook was detached, and oars were passed through holes in the sides and ends of the container to be used as carrying poles. Men shouldered the poles and moved the crate down the ramp onto the quay. The crate was lifted onto a low-slung cart that rested on sturdy, iron-bound wooden wheels, and the horses were harnessed to the cart. The Marines slung their shields and bows over their shoulders, and with spears in hand, formed protective flanks on each side. The captain and the Scythian commander took the lead. The procession surged forward with a clatter of weapons. They marched through the abandoned settlement to a road that had been cut through the forest along the course of the river. Grass had grown up in the track, but the road still afforded rapid progress through the dense woods. On the morning of the third day, the marchers came to a valley between two low mountains. The captain stopped the column and removed from his pack the same cedar box he had consulted on the ship. As the soldiers took a rest break or tended to the horses, he lifted the cover of the box, poured in a small amount of water, and peered in. He glanced from the box to a scroll of vellum that he carried in a cloth sack. Then he pushed on with the unerring determination of a migratory bird. The procession marched through the valley and eventually came to a field where remnants of round millstones were visible through the tall grass. The captain remembered the field when teams of sweating men had turned the stone wheels. Workers had poured baskets full of rocks into the mills, which ground the contents into powder. The powder had been carried over to fire pits. Bellows had stoked the blazes to white-hot intensity. Workers tilted clay crucibles and poured the glowing yellow molten contents into brick-shaped molds. The expedition pushed on and came upon two stone idols. Each statue was twice the height of a man and depicted a more or less human form from the neck down. The idols had been carved to frighten natives away. The nightmarish heads were a combination of animal and human, taking the worst features of each, as if the sculptor intended to create the most hideous and frightening face imaginable. Even the tough mercenaries were ill at ease. They nervously switched their spears from one hand to the other and cast wary glances at the evil-looking idols. The captain consulted his magic box and vellum scroll and plunged into the woods. The procession followed in the artificial twilight created by the canopy of foliage. Thick tree roots were a frequent obstacle, but after about an hour of marching, the procession emerged from the woods. They approached the smooth face of a low rock wall at the base of the ridge. Two more idols, identical to the first pair, barred the way. Using the idols for reference, the captain triangulated a point on the rock wall. He groped along the vertical face like a blind man who had encountered an unexpected obstacle. His probing fingers found a barely visible set of handholds that he used to climb up the side of the wall. About a dozen feet above the ground, he turned his body and sat in a rock hollow. He borrowed a spear, which he inserted in a crack as a lever. The soldiers tossed a rope up, which he attached to the spear shaft. The other end of the rope was tied to a horse. The captain called out a signal, and the horse pulled while he pushed with his feet against a slight outcropping. A thick rock slab about a foot thick detached itself and slammed down with a thud, revealing a cavity about 6 feet wide and 10 feet high. After descending from the rock wall, the captain started a fire in a nest of dry grass, then transferred the fire to a bundle of brush. Holding the torch high, he led the way through the opening. The Scythians had hitched themselves to the harnesses and proceeded to pull the cart through a smooth-walled tunnel which extended for about 50 feet before it opened up into a chamber. The captain lit several oil lamps set into sconces along the walls of the chamber, and the blazing ring of light revealed a large circular gallery with tunnels leading off from it. In the center of the room was a circular section of rock about 3 feet high and 6 feet in diameter. The captain directed the Scythians to raise the crate to the dais. At his order, they removed the lid and stepped back. The captain leaned into the crate and lifted the cover on a slightly smaller, more ornate chest of gold and dark wood. As he peeled away layers of blue cloth, his heart hammered against his ribcage. He stared, transfixed. His face glowed in the reflection coming from the box. After a moment, the captain carefully rearranged the blue cloth and cover. Tarsus's men replaced the lid. "Our mission here is done," he said, his words echoing in the chamber. He led the way outside. The clean, cool air felt good against his sweaty face and cleansed the dust from his lungs. The captain directed the Scythians to lift the stone slab back in place. He studied the wall. No one would suspect that the slab hid the opening. The column set off the way it had come. The procession moved at a brisk pace, without the weight burdening the cart, and marched directly to the river. Built along the sloping shore of the river was a wooden building whose large doors faced the water. The captain inspected the interior of the building. When he emerged, he seemed pleased. He told Tarsa and his men to prepare a fine meal and get a good night's sleep. At dawn, the tireless captain awoke them. The horses dragged a wooden boat from the storehouse and down to the river. The open decked craft was half boat, half raft, around 50 feet long and a dozen or so feet wide, and drew only a few feet of water. A long tiller operated the rudder. The horses were led onto the boat, and it was pushed and pulled into the river to catch the currents. The ride downriver was more hair-raising than their sea voyage. The boat encountered shallows, rapids, drifting trees, whirlpools, and rocks. The Scythians cheered when the boat popped out of the mouth of the river and they saw the brightly striped sails of the ship at its mooring. The ship's crew welcomed the new arrivals and helped drag the riverboat onto shore. A celebration lasted late into the night, but the crew was astir well before dawn, and the sun was just peeking over the trees as they cast off the mooring lines. Powered by the ranks of oarsmen and the wind, the ship moved swiftly out into the bay, the rowers putting their backs into their work because, like every other man on board, they were impatient to return home. And then the exuberance on board the vessel was cut short by an unexpected development. As they were passing an island, a ship pulled out and barred their way. The captain shouted a brisk order to ship oars and drop sails, then climbed onto a large water urn in the bow to better study the vessel. A ship of Tarshish. There was no sign of life on board, but the deck was obscured by a wicker fence for cargo protection that ran along the sheer strake, as the highest hull plank was called. The craft had the same functionally graceful lines as the captain's ship. The deck was long and straight, and the curving stern and horsehead sculpted stem rose high above the water. The captain's razor-sharp eyes picked out important differences between the two ships. This ship had been built for trade and modified for war. The stranger's bow was bound with bronze rather than wood, creating a beak that could tear the heart out of the strongest-built ship. The massive skull and prow oars clamped to the hull could serve as battering rams. The Scythian commander came up to the captain. "Should we send a boarding party?" The captain pondered the question. A Phoenician ship should pose no threat, but there was no reason for the vessel to be where it was. Its actions, while not hostile, were certainly not friendly. "No," the captain said. "We wait." 5 minutes passed, then 10. After 20 minutes, figures could be seen climbing down a ladder into the warship's utility boat. The boat approached to within earshot. There were 4 men at the oars. A 5th stood with legs wide in the prow, his purple cloak billowing out behind him like a loose sail. He cupped his hands to his mouth. "Greetings, my brother," he shouted across the water. "Greetings to you, brother," the captain said with surprise. "How came you here?" A look of mock incredulity appeared on the man's face. He pointed to the warship.
"I came as you did, Menelik, in a ship of Tarshish."
"For what purpose, Melkart?"
"To join forces once again, dear brother."
The captain's face betrayed no emotion, but his dark eyes smoldered with anger. "You knew of my mission?"
"We are family, are we not? There are no secrets among kin."
"Then make no secret to me of your wishes."
"Yes, of course. Come aboard my ship and we'll talk."
"My ship's hospitality is open to you as well." The man in purple laughed.
"It's obvious that we lack brotherly trust."
"Maybe that's because we are only half-brothers."
"We share the same blood nonetheless."
Melkart pointed to the island.
"Let us stop this childish discussion and meet on neutral ground to talk."
The captain studied the island. Unlike most of the heavily treed shoreline, the sandy riverbank was flat for a few hundred feet before rising into a low, grassy ridge.
"Very well," he shouted.
The captain told Tarsa to round up a landing party. Tarsa picked 4 of his most battle-hardened men. Minutes later, the utility boat nudged up to the riverbank. The Scythians stayed with the boat while the captain strode up the sloping beach. His half-brother stood 100 feet from the shore with arms crossed. He was dressed in full Phoenician regalia, with a richly patterned 2-piece tunic under his purple cloak and a conical cap on his head. A gold collar encircled his neck, and his arms and fingers were adorned with gold. He was the captain's equal in height, and his handsome face bore a sharp resemblance to his brother's, with its prominent nose, dark complexion, wavy hair and beard. There were major differences, however. The captain's regal bearing came across as imperious and arrogant, while his half-brother's features were brutish rather than strong. His dark eyes had no depth or softness. His prominent chin hinted at stubbornness rather than determination.
"How wonderful to see you after all these years, dear brother," Melkart said with an engaging smile that had more slyness than charm in it.
The captain was in no mood for insincere niceties. "Why are you here?" he demanded.
"Perhaps our father decided that you needed help on your mission."
"He would never have trusted you."
"He obviously entrusted you, and you're a thief."
The captain's cheeks burned at the insult, but he held his anger in check. "You haven't answered my question." His half-brother shrugged.
"I learned that you were on the move. I tried to intercept you, but your ship was too fast and we fell behind."
"Why has your ship been fit for war?"
"These are dangerous waters."
"You defy our father by coming here. This would not be his wish."
"Our father."
He spit out the words.
"Our father was a womanizer who slept with your whore of a mother."
"And your whore of a mother as well?" Melkart pulled his purple robe back. His hand started toward the pommel of his sword, but he thought better of it and drew his hand back.
"We are foolish to quarrel over family matters," he soothed. "Let us go back to my ship. I will serve you refreshments, and we can talk."
"There is nothing to talk about. You will turn your ship back. We will follow." The captain spun on his heel and strode back toward the river. He kept his ear cocked for footfalls in the unlikely event that his brother found the courage to attack him. But the only sound he heard was Tarsa, who cried out,
"Captain, behind you!"
The Scythian had seen a dozen or so figures rise from the grassy ridge behind the beach. The captain wheeled and saw men sprinting in his direction. Tattoos decorated their shoulders and chests. Thracians. Another fierce-eyed race that hired out its skills with the sword and javelin to the Phoenician navies. The Thracians swept by his half-brother, who urged them on.
"Kill him! Kill him!"
The captain drew his short broadsword and turned to face the screaming Thracians, who quickly encircled him. He pivoted to face his attackers, but he couldn't guard his back. A Thracian moved in with his javelin in throwing position, only to stop short and drop his weapon. Clutching at the feathered shaft protruding from his throat, he let out a wet cough, sank to his knees, and fell forward face first into the sand. Tarsa calmly notched another arrow to his bowstring. With no more effort than taking a breath, he killed a second Thracian. The others scattered. Tarsa's bowmen unleashed a deadly rain of arrows that found their mark in the backs of the fleeing Thracians. The captain let out a mighty war cry and ran up the beach. He swung his sword in a powerful blow that would have decapitated his half-brother if Melkart hadn't sideslipped the blade in a desperate parry. Under the flurry of blows that followed, Melkart tripped over his robes and fell in the soft sand. He rolled onto his back and threw his sword aside.
"Don't kill me, my brother."
The captain hesitated. Evil as he was, Melkart was still a blood relative. Tarsa shouted another warning. A second wave of Thracians had appeared on the ridge to reinforce the first line of attackers. The captain backed off and dashed for the boat, leaping over the dead bodies of the attackers. The Scythians unleashed their last arrows. The hastily aimed shots slowed the Thracians' advance, but didn't stop it. Tarsa threw his bow aside, grabbed the captain in his powerful arms, and lifted him into the boat. The rowers pulled at the oars and put the boat quickly out of range of the javelins, which splashed harmlessly into the water behind them. The captain climbed onto the deck of his ship. The lookout man was handing out spears and swords, which had been neatly organized in an on-deck weapons room. Melkart's boat pushed off from the beach with the last of the Thracians. The wicker fence on board the warship dropped to reveal at least 100 men on a raised combat deck. The sun glinted off their spear tips. Their shields were hung over the balustrade to create a defensive wall. The captain saw plumes of smoke rising from the deck and ordered urns of water placed around the ship. Trailed by thin streaks of smoke, flaming arrows dipped in pitch rose into the sky and arced down from the skies in a fiery shower. No arrows found a human target, but some stuck in the sides and deck of the ship. The flames were doused with water from the urns, but another volley followed the first, and some of the flaming arrows landed in the furled sail. Crewmen pulled the sail onto the deck and stamped on the blazing cloth, ignoring the glowing embers that burned their feet and legs. The captain barked an order to lift anchor. As the Scythians unleashed a deadly volley of arrows for cover, the rowers moved the ship backward out of range of the fire arrows. But the river currents pushed the ship so that it was broadside to the other vessel. The flames from the sail were spreading. The captain knew that his vessel was doomed. Ships were made of wood, hemp, pitch, and cloth. Within minutes, the vessel would become a huge flaming torch. The warship was preparing to come in for the kill. The large oars at both ends of the ship were being used to swing the vessel rapidly around in a 180-degree turn that would bring the bronze battering ram into play. The ram would punch a hole in the burning ship. Once the ship foundered, it would be peppered with more fire arrows. Grenades filled with flaming oil or flaming pots would be suspended from the bow on poles. The captain ordered the helmsman to turn the ship. When the bow pointed downstream, he yelled to the rowers, "Full speed ahead!" The ship lurched like a lazy whale and gained speed. The enemy vessel was still turning and would never be in a more vulnerable position. Although the prow of the captain's ship was not sheathed with metal, the thick Lebanese timbers could be used with deadly effect. Hooves thundered amid the shouts of men. The horses had broken loose from their stable and had climbed up a ramp onto the deck. The Scythians dropped their bows and tried to drive the horses back below. The animals reared and rolled their eyes, more frightened of the smoke and fire than of the noisy human beings. The ships were yards apart. The captain could see a figure in purple striding from one end of the deck to the other as Melkart urged his crew to move faster. The burning vessel crunched into the warship. The captain lost his footing and fell to his knees, but quickly climbed back to his feet. The horsehead figurehead hung at an angle, he saw. The ship had bounced back and was being swung by the current so that its hull would be side by side with the other vessel. Now the enemy archers could pick them off at will, and spear-carrying warriors would swarm aboard to finish the job. Discipline had broken down on his ship. Men ran about the burning deck trying to avoid being cremated or trampled by the rampaging horses. The ships crunched up against one another. A gust of wind cleared the smoke for an instant. The captain saw the grinning face of his brother staring at him from only a few yards away. Galvanized, the captain waded along the main deck through clouds of smoke and tried to rally his panicked crew. A horse reared up in front of the captain, and he had to draw back to avoid being crushed. Suddenly inspired, he plucked a shred of burning sail from the deck and waved it at the horse. The animal reared and pawed the air with its sharp hooves. He yelled at the Scythians to follow his lead. A ragged line formed. Shouting and brandishing pieces of flaming cloth or leather shirts in the air, they herded the horses against the low ship's rail. Tattooed Thracians lined the rail on the other vessel, their eyes glittering in anticipation of the massacre. But then the horses half leaped and half climbed over the rail and onto the deck of the warship. Their animals crashed through the line of warriors and raced madly from one end of the deck to the other, trampling anyone in their way. The captain vaulted over the rail with the Scythians close behind, and with a quick thrust of his sword, dropped the first man he encountered. Then his entire crew swarmed aboard. The Thracians drew back in confusion under the fierce attack. The captain's face was black with soot. He was bleeding from several non-fatal sword and spear wounds, but he moved inexorably toward Melkart, who had seen the tide of the battle turn and was trying to find safety at the raised aft end of the ship. Menelik climbed a short ladder to the stern where his half-brother cowered. This time, he would not hesitate to deliver the fatal blow. As his sword struck living flesh, however, something hard crashed into the captain's skull, and he crumpled to the deck, a curtain of blackness falling over his eyes. Later, when the last trace of the battle had bubbled to the surface, the silent witness who had been hiding in the grass made his way cautiously along the beach, not far from where he had first seen the horsehead monster. All was quiet. The cries of pain and agony and the clash of weapons had faded. There was only the soft ripple of water along the riverbank, which was littered with the dead. He went from body to body, ignoring gold ornaments in favor of more useful items. He was bending over to pick up more booty when he heard a pitiful meow. The soggy mass of yellowish-orange fur had its claws dug into a charred board. The hunter had never seen a cat before, and, for a moment, he considered killing it. But he relented, and instead wrapped the animal in a soft leather cloth. When he could carry no more, he stole away, leaving only his footprints in the sand. The White House, 1809. The executive mansion on Pennsylvania Avenue was dark except for the study, where a crackling fire in the hearth kept the winter chill at bay. The flickering yellow firelight bathed the high-nosed profile of the man who sat at a desk, humming as he worked. Thomas Jefferson glanced at the wall clock with the bright blue-gray eyes whose intensity often startled those who met him for the first time. It was 2 a.m. He usually retired at 10. He had been working in the study since 6 o'clock in the evening, having risen at dawn. The president had taken his afternoon ride around Washington on his favorite horse, Eagle, and still wore his riding clothes. A comfortable, worn brown jacket, red waistcoat, corduroy pants, and woolen socks. He had exchanged his riding boots for the slippers without heels that had shocked foreign envoys who'd expected more regal footwear gracing the presidential feet. The president's long arm reached out to a cabinet. The doors flew open at the touch of his finger, a feature that appealed to Jefferson's love of gadgetry. Stacked neatly inside the cabinet were a cut glass goblet, a decanter filled with French red wine, a plate of cakes, and a night candle used to navigate the corridors back to his bedroom. He poured half a glass of wine, held it dreamily to the light, and took a sip that brought back fond memories of Paris. Tomorrow could not come too soon. Within hours, the onerous burden of office would be shifted to the narrow but capable shoulders of his friend James Madison. He savored another sip and returned to the papers spread out on his desk. Written in the same flowing hand that had penned the Declaration of Independence were specimens, arranged in columns, of more than 50 Indian vocabularies collected over a 30-year period. Jefferson had long been obsessed with the question of how the Indians came to North America, and had spent years compiling lists of words commonly used in Indian languages and dialects. His theory was that similarities between words from the Old and New World might offer a clue to the Indians' origin. Jefferson had shamelessly exercised his presidential power in pursuit of his obsession. He had once invited 5 Cherokee chiefs to a White House reception and quizzed them about their language. He had instructed Meriwether Lewis to collect vocabularies from the Indians the explorer encountered on his historic journey to the Pacific Ocean. The book Jefferson planned to write on the origins of the Indian would be the culmination of his intellectual career. The tumultuous events of his second term had temporarily stalled the project, and he had put off sending the lists to the printer until he could write digests of the reams of new material Lewis and Clark had brought back from their trek. Vowing to tend to the task as soon as he was back at Monticello, he stacked the papers into a neat pile, tied it with string, and placed it with the other vocabularies and stationery in a sturdy trunk. It would be transported with his belongings to the James River and loaded onto a boat that would take his baggage to Monticello. He placed the last packet of documents in the trunk and snapped the cover shut. His desk was clear now, except for a pewter box, his name embossed on the lid. The president opened the box and removed a rectangular piece of vellum about 10 by 12 inches in size. He held the soft animal hide close to an oil lamp. The pebbled surface was covered with strange writing, wavy lines and X's. One edge was ragged. He had acquired the vellum in 1791. He and his Virginian neighbor, Jemmy Madison, had ridden on horseback to Long Island, New York, to meet some impoverished remnants of the Uncachog tribe. Jefferson had hoped to find someone who knew the ancient languages of the Algonquin tribe, and in fact, three elderly women could still speak the old language, and Jefferson had compiled a glossary from them that he hoped would help prove his thesis about the European origin of the Indians. It was there that the chief of the tribe presented Jefferson with the vellum, saying it had been passed down from generation to generation. Touched by the gesture, Jefferson had asked a rich landowner and fellow signer of the Declaration to provide for the Indians. Looking at the vellum now, Jefferson had an idea. He took it over to a table where a horizontal wooden easel had two pens suspended from a framework that allowed them to move simultaneously. Jefferson regularly used this copying machine, known as a polygraph, for his voluminous correspondence. He copied the vellum markings and added notes asking the recipient to identify the language in which the words were written. Then he addressed and sealed the envelopes and placed them in a basket for outgoing mail. The Uncachog word lists were packed with the other papers in the trunk. Jefferson wanted to keep the vellum close and placed it back in the box. He would carry the box in his saddlebags on the ride to Monticello. He glanced at the wall clock again, drained his wine glass, and rose from his chair. At the age of 65, Jefferson hadn't an ounce of surplus flesh on his farmer's body. His thick hair was going from reddish blonde to sandy gray as he aged. With his square-shouldered musket-barrel posture and 6'2" height, he would always be an imposing figure. Inflammatory arthritis was making inroads, but after he worked the stiffness out of his limbs, his movements were flexible and easy, and he moved with the grace of a younger man. He lit his night candle and made his way along the silent White House corridors to his bedroom. Up at dawn, he rode to the new president's inauguration with his usual lack of pomp and ceremony. With a touch of his hat, he simply galloped past the waiting cavalry escort, dismounted near the Capitol, and hitched his horse to a picket fence. Then he sat with the public during the inauguration and paid a farewell visit at the White House. Later, at the inaugural ball, he danced with Dolly Madison. The next day, he finished packing, making certain in particular that the trunk with his Indian material was on the wagon that would take it to the James River. Setting off on horseback from Monticello, he rode 8 hours, even through a driving snowstorm, in his eagerness to resume life as a country gentleman. The watcher stood in the shadow of a snow-covered oak tree near the edge of the James River, where several cargo boats were tied up for the night. Raucous laughter emanated from a nearby tavern. The voices were growing louder, and he judged from personal experience that the boat crews had reached the last stage before drinking themselves senseless. He emerged from the protection of darkness and made his way over the snow-covered ground to a boat that was outlined faintly in the flickering light of its stern lantern. The 50-foot-long bateau was a narrow, flat-bottomed craft designed to move tobacco along the river. He stood on shore and called out, receiving no answer. Enticed by the prospects of drink, a warm fire, and female company, the captain had gone ashore with the two pole men who worked the riverboat. Crime was practically unknown in this remote part of the river, and none of the boats felt the need to leave crew aboard on this cold night. The watcher padded up the ramp and used the lamp hanging from the stern to light his way as he ducked under an arched awning covering the central part of the deck. The awning sheltered more than 24 bundles stenciled with the initials TJ. He set the light down and began to go through the baggage and boxes. He pried a trunk open with a knife and pulled out a handful of the papers neatly packed inside. As he'd been instructed, he stuffed the papers into a large sack and threw a handful onto the riverbank. He tossed more papers into the river, where they drifted out of sight on the swift currents. The man grinned at his accomplishment. With a quick glance toward the noisy tavern, he crept silently down the gangway onto the riverbank and melted like a ghost into the darkness. Soon after, Jefferson was returning to Monticello with friends and saw his house slaves unloading boxes from a wagon drawn close to the mansion's columned entrance. As he rode closer, he recognized a stocky, bearded figure as the captain of the James River boat carrying his baggage from Washington. He dismounted and strode to the wagon, but in his excitement at seeing his baggage arrive, he didn't notice the boatman's stricken expression. He rapped his knuckles on the side of the wagon. "Good work, Captain. All arrived safe and sound, I see." The captain's round face crumpled like an overripe pumpkin. "Not all, I'm sorry to say, sir," he mumbled. "What do you mean?" The captain seemed to shrink into himself. Jefferson towered over the riverman by several inches and would have been a formidable figure even if he hadn't been the former president of the United States. He seemed to bore holes right through the hapless captain with eyes almost luminous in their intensity. As the riverman told his story, he wrung his hat so tight it was a wonder that he didn't tear it into pieces. Jefferson's trunk had been vandalized on the last leg of the boat's journey while ascending the river above Richmond. The thief had boarded the boat while it was tied up and the crew was sleeping on shore, the captain said. And he must have dumped the contents of the trunk into the river. The captain handed Jefferson some mud-smeared papers, explaining that they had been found on the riverbank. Jefferson stared at the wet wad in his hand. Barely able to get the words out, he said, "Nothing else stolen?" "No, sir." The captain brightened at the opportunity to point out the silver lining. "Only the one trunk." "Only the one trunk." The words echoed in Jefferson's ears as if they were being spoken in a cave. "Tell me where you found this," he demanded. Moments later, Jefferson and his friends galloped off and rode until they came to the river, then fanned out along both sides. After an intensive search, they fished out some papers that had floated ashore. Except for a few sheets, the mud-caked specimens of Indian vocabularies were water-damaged beyond use. Later that summer, a petty thief and drunk was arrested and charged with the crime. The man claimed he had been hired by a stranger to steal the papers and pretend they were destroyed. Jefferson was glad the culprit had been caught and might be hanged. He took no interest in the man's fate. The scoundrel had caused him an irreparable loss. Jefferson had more pressing problems, such as tending his long-neglected fields and trying to figure out how to pay his mounting debts. That was all changed months later when a letter arrived in the mail. Jefferson had received several replies from the notes he had mailed from the White House to members of the Philosophical Society. All expressed their puzzlement at the word lists Jefferson had transcribed from the vellum, except for one. Professor Holmberg was a linguist at Oxford University. He apologized for not answering Jefferson sooner, but he had been traveling in North Africa. He knew exactly what language the words were written in and enclosed translations. Jefferson's eyes widened as he read Holmberg's findings. With the letter in hand, he roamed his library and plucked volume after volume from his bookshelves. History, language, religion. He spent the next several hours reading and making notes. When he had pushed away the last book, he sat back in his chair, tented his fingers, and stared into space. After a moment lost in thought, Jefferson silently mouthed a familiar name. Meriwether Lewis. Fate had not dealt kindly with the man who had led the expedition that opened the floodgates of the American West to United States expansion. Lewis was a man of extraordinary talents. Jefferson had been aware of his fellow Virginian's qualities when he'd asked Lewis to lead the exploratory expedition to the Pacific coast in 1803. Educated, intrepid, versed in the sciences, tough physically, Lewis was an outdoorsman familiar with Indian customs and possessed of a sterling character. He'd been a well-respected army captain before he had come to work for Jefferson in the White House, where he added diplomacy, statesmanship, and politics to his quiver of talents. The expedition had been successful beyond belief. After Lewis returned to Washington in 1806 with William Clark, the expedition's co-leader, Jefferson had appointed him as governor of the Louisiana Territory. Lewis had reason to wonder, however, whether the appointment was a reward or a punishment. Even with all his talents and energy, Lewis had a hard time trying to tame the wild frontier. The explorer's political enemies were relentless. One night, after Lewis had spent another wearying day dealing with charges that he'd spent government money on a fur company in which he had an interest, he saw a sealed packet on his desk and immediately recognized Jefferson's handwriting. Lewis had a smile on his hawk-nosed face as he slid a knife blade under the seal and carefully unwrapped the stiff paper that enclosed a stack of documents. The note inside said, "My dear Mr. Lewis, your gardens might benefit from the information contained within. T.J." The next page was entitled "The Cultivation of Artichokes." The pages contained a detailed treatise, complete with planting tables and a garden diagram. He spread the contents of the packet on his desktop, his brow wrinkled in puzzlement. Lewis knew of Jefferson's interest in gardening, but it seemed strange that he would take the trouble to send information on artichoke cultivation halfway across the continent. He must have known that Lewis's crushing responsibilities left no time for gardening. Then, the light of comprehension dawned on Lewis's long face, and his pulse quickened. He pawed through the shelves of a cabinet where he had stored the reports from the Lewis and Clark expedition and found what he was looking for within minutes. Sandwiched between two bundles of documents was a sheet of heavy paper, which he extracted and held up to the light. The sheet was perforated with dozens of small rectangular holes, and with trembling fingers, he placed the matrix over the first written page in the artichoke file and copied the letters that showed through the holes onto a separate sheet of paper. When Jefferson had conceived the idea for the Pacific expedition, he knew that Lewis would be in a diplomatically sensitive position, exploring territory held by France and Spain. Behind Jefferson's sphinx-like imperturbability was a mind as devious as any to be found in the courts and palaces of Europe. In corresponding with his minister to France, he had often used a cipher, which he described as a mask when we need it. While Lewis was in Philadelphia preparing for his journey with leading scientists from the Philosophical Society, Jefferson sent him a cipher he had worked up for the expedition. He based the encryption method on the Visionnaire cipher widely used in Europe. The system involved an alphanumeric table and was unlocked with a keyword: artichokes. It had not been necessary to use the cipher during the expedition, which was why Lewis had been baffled at seeing it utilized. Casting questions aside now, he attacked the enciphered message with the enthusiasm he brought to all challenges. As he deciphered each letter from the gibberish, the words began to form before his eyes. "Dear Mr. Lewis, I hope this missive finds you well. I have taken the liberty of submitting this report to you in the enciphered form upon which we had agreed, with the goal that it should be for your eyes only and for your sole disposition. I fear that the information enclosed, whether true or not, would excite certain passions, cause men to go into territory where they were ill prepared to survive, and create problems with the Indians. I understood that you were fully engaged in the formidable task of placing a harness on the Louisiana stallion, but plead your assistance in resolving this matter. Your obedient servant, T.J. Lewis deciphered the balance of the encrypted message. Then he went back to the garden diagram. The lines, X's, circles, and words penned in an unknown language began to make sense of sorts. He was looking at a map, and something about it struck him as familiar. He pawed through dozens of his charts and documents and found what he was looking for. Taking up pen and paper, he wrote a brief note. He thanked Jefferson for his gardening advice and said he had located an ideal spot for his crop to flourish, then told Jefferson that he would discuss gardening when he came to Washington to clear his name. Lewis planned to start down the Mississippi River early in September 1809. He would let Jefferson know when he had arrived in Washington. It was not to be. Late that fall, Jefferson received a note from a Major Neely saying that Lewis had died of gunshot wounds on the Natchez Trace Wilderness Road. He was only 35. The loss of the talented young man was incomprehensible to Jefferson. It almost seemed as if an ancient curse hovered over the Indian vocabularies. Several weeks later, Major Neely arrived at Monticello with Lewis's young slave. While Neely was cleaning up from his ride, the slave timidly handed Jefferson a packet and whispered a message. Instructing his staff that he not be disturbed, Jefferson locked himself in his study and studied the packet's contents. Then he compiled a thorough written analysis of the events leading to Lewis's death. The dawn's light was streaming through the windows as he summed up the synopsis in a single underlined word: conspiracy. What if his Indian word lists had been stolen, as the thief had claimed? What if someone knew that Jefferson's research held the key to an age-old secret? What if the death of Lewis were not a suicide, but murder? Jefferson spent several more days working in his study. When he emerged, brandishing a list of instructions for his staff, he seemed like a man possessed. One night, under cover of darkness, he rode off on his horse, followed in a wagon by his most trusted slaves. Weeks later, they returned, looking tired and disheveled, but there was a glint of triumph in Jefferson's eye. He considered the implications of his discovery. He had done everything in his power to keep the United States from being contaminated by the deadly alliance of church and state that had spawned the religious wars which had raged on the continent. He feared that if this information were made public, it could shake the foundations of the young country and even destroy the fledgling republic he had helped create. Without pausing to clean up or change, Jefferson plunged into his study and penned a long letter to his old friend and sometimes nemesis, John Adams. As he sealed the envelope, a smile crossed his weary face. He could play at the conspiracy game as well as anyone. Chapter 1. Baghdad, Iraq, 2003. Carina Mechadi was incandescent with rage. The young Italian woman threw off sparks like a Roman candle as she surveyed the rubble that littered the administrative offices of the Iraqi National Museum. Cabinets had been overturned. Files were scattered as if they'd been caught up in a whirlwind. Desks and chairs had been smashed to splinters. The vindictiveness of the destruction was appalling. Carina unleashed a withering outburst that dissected the parentage, sexual orientation, and prowess of the vandals who had wreaked such senseless havoc. The wave of blue language washed over the young U.S. Marine corporal who had been hovering protectively nearby, cradling an M4 carbine in his arms. The only two Italian words the Marine knew were pepperoni and pizza. He didn't need a lexicon to tell him that he'd witnessed a display of razor-edged invective worthy of a longshoreman with a sore back. The muscular language was all the more amazing considering its source. Carina was a foot shorter than the Marine. The battle gear the military people had insisted she wear made the slender woman appear even smaller. She looked like a turtle too small for its shell in the borrowed flak jacket. The desert camouflage uniform was meant for a small man. The helmet that concealed her long sable hair sat so low it almost hid her cornflower blue eyes. Carina noticed the Marine's astonished grin. She blushed with embarrassment and brought her tirade to a halt. "Sorry about that." "No problem, ma'am," the corporal said. "You ever want to be a drill instructor, the Marine Corps would be glad to have you." The heat faded from her dusky face. Full lips that seemed better suited for seduction than for swearing widened in a broad smile that revealed perfect white teeth. With the fire in her words extinguished, her voice was low and cool. Speaking with a slight accent, she said, "Thank you for the offer, Corporal O'Leary." She glanced at the rubble at her feet. "As you can see, I'm quite passionate when it comes to this sort of thing."
"Don't blame you for being pissed."
The Marine's cheeks flushed and he glanced away.
"Excuse me, I mean for being mad, ma'am. Hell of a mess."
Saddam Hussein's elite Republican Guard had set up a defensive position in the 11-acre museum complex in the heart of Baghdad on the western bank of the Tigris. The Iraqi troops had run for their lives in the face of the American advance, leaving the museum unguarded for 36 hours. Hundreds of plunderers had rampaged through the complex until they were chased out by the senior staff. The Republican guards had shed their uniforms and burned piles of identity cards in their hurry to return to civilian life. In a last gasp of defiance, someone had scrawled, "Death to all Americans," on a courtyard wall.
"We've seen all we need to see here," Carina said with a grimace.
With Corporal O'Leary trailing a few paces behind, she plodded out of the administrative offices. Her leaden-footed gait was only partly the fault of the army boots on her feet. She was weighed down by a feeling of dread at what she would find, or not find, in the public gallery where the museum's prize holdings were exhibited in more than 500 display cases. The walk down the long central corridor only served to heighten her fears. A number of sarcophagi had been cracked open and statues decapitated. Carina set foot in the first gallery
and the air involuntarily escaped from her lungs. She wandered from room to room as if in a daze. Every case looked as if it had been vacuumed clean. She entered a gallery that had held Babylonian artifacts. A portly, middle-aged man was bent over a smashed cabinet. Standing next to him was a young Iraqi who raised his AK-47 when they entered. The Marine brought the carbine to his shoulder. The heavy-set man looked up and stared through thick lenses at the Marine. There was disdain rather than fear in his eyes. His glance shifted to Carina and his face lit up in a 14-carat smile.
"My dear Miss Mechadi," he said with undisguised warmth. "Hello, Dr. Nasser. Glad to see that you're all right."
Carina turned to the Marine.
"Corporal, this is Mohammed Yassim Nasser. He's senior curator here at the museum."
The Marine lowered his weapon. After a pause to show that he had not been intimidated by the American, the Iraqi did the same with his gun. They continued to eye each other warily.
Nasser came over to clasp Karina's hands in his. "You shouldn't have come so soon. It is still dangerous." "You are here, Professor?" "Of course. This institution has been my lifeblood."
"I understand completely," Carina said. "But the area around the museum is secure."
She nodded toward her Marine escort.
"Besides, Corporal O'Leary is keeping close watch on me."
Nasser's brow clouded over.
"I hope this gentleman is a better guard than his friends were. If not for my brave colleagues, the disaster would have been total."
Carina understood Nasser's anger. The American troops arrived 4 days after the museum's curators had told the commanders about the looting. Carina had tried desperately to have them move in sooner. She had waved the UNESCO identification card hanging around her neck under the noses of the American officers, only to be told that the situation was too fluid and dangerous. Carina saw no use arguing over who was to blame. The damage had already been done.
"I've talked to the Americans," she said. "They said there would have been a bloody battle if they came in earlier."
Nasser shot a drop-dead glance in the Marine's direction.
"I understand. They were too busy guarding the oil wells."
The unsympathetic expression on his nut-brown face suggested that he would have preferred bloodshed to looting.
"I'm as sickened as you are," she said. "This is terrible."
"Well, it's not as bad as it seems here," Nasser said with unexpected optimism. "The artifacts taken from this case were minor items. Fortunately, the museum had put together a contingency plan after the 1991 invasion. The curators moved most of the artifacts to safe rooms known only to the 5 most senior museum officers."
"That's wonderful, Professor."
Nasser's sunny mood was short-lived. He tugged fretfully at his beard.
"I wish the rest of the news were as good," he said, with a doleful note in his voice. "Other parts of the museum did not fare as well. The thieves looted the greatest treasures of Mesopotamia. They took the sacred vase and the mask of Warka, the Bazetki statue, the ivory of the lioness attacking the Nubian, and the twin copper bulls.
Those objects are priceless.
Unlike the petty thieves we chased out of the museum, the people who removed the more valuable antiquities were sophisticated. They bypassed the black obelisk, for instance."
"They must have known that the original is in the Louvre."
Nasser's lips tightened in a grim smile.
"They didn't touch any copies. They were very organized and selective. Come, I'll show you."
Nasser led the way to the above-ground storage rooms. The shelves lining the walls were empty. Dozens of jars, vessels, and shards littered the floor. Carina kicked away an army uniform.
"The Republican guards spent time here as well," she said.
Any idea of how much is missing? It will take years to assess the loss. I'm estimating around 3,000 or so pieces gone. I wish I could say that was the worst of it.
They walked into a gallery that displayed Roman antiquities. The professor pushed aside a corner shelf to reveal a hidden door whose glass paneling had been smashed and steel grate bent back. He fumbled in his pocket for a candle and a cigarette lighter. They descended the narrow set of stairs to metal doors that were wide open with no sign of forced entry. A wall sealed the space beyond the door. The concrete bricks had been pried away to make a large opening. They climbed through the opening into a hot and airless room. An acrid stench assaulted their nostrils. Footprints on the dusty floor had been cordoned off with yellow tape placed at the crime scene by a team of investigators. Carina glanced around.
Where are we?
The basement storage area. There are 5 rooms down here. Few people in the museum even know this place exists. That's why we thought the collection was safe. We were wrong, as you can see.
He moved the candle in an arc. Its yellow light fell upon dozens of plastic fishing boxes thrown willy-nilly around the room.
I've never seen such absolute chaos, Carina whispered. The boxes held cylinder seals, beads, coins, glass bottles, amulets, and jewelry. Thousands of items are missing.
He brought the candle over to dozens of larger plastic boxes that lined the walls.
They didn't bother with these. Apparently, they knew they were empty.
Corporal O'Leary surveyed the wreckage with a street fighter's eye for entrances and exits.
If you don't mind my asking, sir, how'd they know how to find this place?
Nasser's heavy features drooped and he gave a glum nod of his head.
You Americans aren't the only ones who have reason to be embarrassed.
We suspect someone on our staff with intimate knowledge of the museum alerted the thieves to this room. We have fingerprinted our staff, except for the head of security, who has not come back to reclaim his job.
I was wondering why I didn't see any evidence of the door being forced, Carina said.
The thieves came into the basement the same way we did, but they had forgotten torches or never expected they would need them.
He picked up a piece of burned rubber foam.
They used this material from upstairs for torchlight. This stuff burns quickly and the fumes would have been terrible.
We found a set of keys on the floor. They probably dropped the keys and couldn't find them. They missed 30 cabinets with our best cylinder seals and tens of thousands of gold and silver coins. I'd guess about 10,000 excavated artifacts are missing. Hundreds of boxes were left intact, praise Allah.
They filed through a doorway into a larger space filled with antiquities of every size and shape.
These are objects that were given a preliminary identification and were to be absorbed into the main collection as work allowed. Some have been stored here for years.
The footprints lead in here, Carina said.
The thieves evidently thought there was something of value in this room. We would have no way of knowing until we go over our inventory. We are far too busy trying to retrieve more precious items.
I heard there was an amnesty, she said.
That's right. It has somewhat restored some of my faith in human nature. People have brought in thousands of items, including the mask of Worka. I expect that objects will continue to be returned, but, as you know, the most valuable ones are probably in the possession of some wealthy collector in New York or London.
Carina sighed in agreement. The thefts had been carefully planned. The invasion took weeks to gear up. Unscrupulous dealers in Europe and the United States could take advance orders for specific objects from rich clients.
The antiquities business had become almost as lucrative as drug trafficking. London and New York were the main markets. Stolen antiquities from illegal excavations in Greece, Italy, and South America were often laundered through Switzerland, where objects can gain legal title after only 5 years in the country. Carina stood in silence amid the empty boxes, apparently lost in thought. After a moment, she said, "Perhaps I can speed up the amnesty process."
"But how? We have spread the word far and wide."
She turned to the Marine.
"I'll need your help, Corporal O'Leary."
"I was ordered to comply with any request you asked for, ma'am." Carina spread her lips in a mysterious smile.
"I was counting on that."
End of Disc 1.
Chapter 2. The pavement shook under the treads of the 25-ton Bradley fighting vehicle, warning of the troop carrier's approach long before it rumbled into view. By the time the vehicle had turned the corner and rolled down the deserted boulevard, the man who had been making his way along the boulevard had slipped into an alley. He ducked into a doorway where he would be invisible to the vehicle's night vision scope. The man watched the vehicle until it disappeared around another corner before he ventured from the alley. The thud of bombs that had presaged the advance of the American-led forces had stopped. The rattle of small arms fire was constant but sporadic. Except for the firefights that ensued as the invaders mopped up pockets of resistance, there had been a pause in the battle as the coalition and the remnants of the defenders considered their next step. He passed a defaced statue of Saddam Hussein and walked another 10 minutes until he came to a side street. Using a penlight that cast a thin red beam, he studied a city map, then tucked the map and light back into his pocket and turned down the street. Although he was a big man, several inches over 6 feet, he moved through the pitch-dark city as silently as a shadow. His stealth was a skill he had developed through weeks of training at a camp run by former members of the French Foreign Legion, U.S. Delta Force, and British Special Ops. He could infiltrate the most heavily guarded installation to carry out his mission. Although he was adept in the use of a dozen different methods of assassination, his weapon of choice was the crushing strength in his large, thick-fingered hands. He had come a long way from his humble beginnings. His family had been living in a small town in the south of Spain when his benefactor found him. He'd been in his late teens and working in a slaughterhouse. He enjoyed the work of dispatching everything from chickens to cows and tried to bring some creativity to the task whenever he could, but something in him yearned for greater things. It almost hadn't happened. He had strangled an annoying co-worker to death over a petty argument. Charged with murder, he had languished in jail while headlines made much of the fact that he was the son of the man who had been Spain's official garrotter back in the days when strangulation was the state-approved method of execution. One day, the man who would become his benefactor arrived at the jailhouse in a chauffeur-driven car. He sat in the cell and told the young man, "You have a proud and glorious past, and a great future." The youth listened with rapt attention as the stranger talked about the family's service to the state. He knew that the youth's father had been put out of work after the garrot machine was retired in 1974, how he had changed his name and retreated to a small farm where the family pursued a pitiful subsistence living, and died, penniless and heartbroken, leaving a widow and child. His benefactor wanted the young man to work for him. He paid off the jailers and the judge, gave the grieving family more money than the dead chicken plucker could have earned in 100 lifetimes, and the charges against the young man disappeared. He was sent to a private school where he learned several languages, and after he graduated, he was trained in military skills. The professional killers who took him under their wing recognized, as had his benefactor, that he was a talented student. Soon he was being sent on solo missions to remove those who were selected by his benefactor. The phone call would come with instructions. The mission would be carried out, and money would be deposited in his Swiss bank account. Before coming to Baghdad, he had murdered an activist priest who was stirring up opposition to one of his benefactor's mines in Peru. He'd been on his way back to Spain when he got the message to slip into Iraq ahead of the American invasion, and there he had taken up residence in a small hotel and made the necessary contacts. He had been disappointed to learn that his assignment was not to kill, but to arrange for the removal of an object from the Baghdad Museum. On the positive side, however, he had virtually a front-row seat to the invasion, with its resultant death and destruction. He studied the map again and grunted with satisfaction. He was minutes away from his destination. Chapter 3. With electrical power out in the city, Carina had a hard time finding the squat concrete building in the older section of Baghdad. She had been there once before, in daylight, and not in the middle of a war. The building's windows had been boarded over, giving it the aspect of a fortress. As she strode up to the thick wooden door, she could hear the pop of small arms fire in the distance. She tried the heavy cast-iron handle. The door was unlocked, and she pushed it open and stepped inside. The gauzy glow of oil lamps illuminated the faces of men hunched over backgammon boards and glasses of tea. The atmosphere was like the inside of an exhaust pipe. The thick, choking smoke produced by dozens of cigarettes and water pipes had taken only a slight edge off the sweaty odor of unwashed bodies. The low murmur of male voices halted, as if a switch had been turned off. Although most of the unshaven faces were cloaked in shadow, she knew that she was the target of hostile eyes. Two figures detached themselves from a dark corner like creatures crawling out of a swamp. One man slipped around behind her, shut the door, and cut off any possible escape. The other man confronted her head-on. Speaking in Arabic, he growled, "Who are you?" His breath was foul with stale tobacco and garlic. Resisting the natural impulse to gag, Carina stood to her full 5'5" height. "Tell Ali that Mechadi wants to see him." Female assertiveness had its limits with Arab men. An arm snaked around her neck from behind and squeezed tight. The man standing in front produced a knife and held it so close to her left eye that its sharp point was a blur. She croaked out a feeble call for help. The door opened with a crash. The arm relaxed around her neck. Corporal O'Leary stood in the doorway, the muzzle of his carbine pressed against the base of the door guard's skull. The Marine had heard Carina over a walkie-talkie tuned to the same channel as the one clipped to her vest. A Humvee was parked across the street. The vehicle's top lights were on, and those inside the tea house had a clear view of the long barrel of the M2 machine gun mounted on the vehicle's roof. The gun was aimed at the door. A squad of Marines stood in the street with rifles in attack position. The Marine kept his eyes on the man with the knife. "You okay, ma'am?"
"Yes, thank you," she said, rubbing her neck. "I'm fine."
"Crash course I took in Arabic didn't teach me how to tell this guy I will splatter his brains around the room if his friend doesn't drop the knife." Carina did a rough but effective translation. The knife clattered to the floor, and the Marine kicked it out of reach. The thugs almost tripped over themselves as they retreated back into the murk that had spawned them. A voice called out in English from behind a curtain at the back of the tea house.
"Peace be upon you."
Carina responded to the traditional Arabic greeting.
"Peace be upon you, Ali."
A man emerged from between the dingy sheets of cotton that served as curtains and wove his way around the close-packed tables.
The light from the Humvee fell on his pudgy face and fleshy nose. A circular knit cap covered his shaven head. His New York Yankees t-shirt was too short for his ample body, exposing his hairy belly button. "Welcome, Signora Mechadi," he said. He clasped his palms together. "And to your friends, the same." "Your man was about to stick a knife in my eye," Carina responded. "Is that how you welcome guests?" Ali's small, cunning eyes surveyed Karina's body and lingered on her face. "You're wearing a military uniform," he said with an unctuous smile. "Perhaps he thought you were an enemy soldier." Carina ignored Ali's comment. "I want to talk to you." The Iraqi scratched a scraggly black beard that had bits of food caught in it. "Of course. Let us step out back and have some tea." The Marine spoke up. "Do you want me to go with you?"
"I'll be all right."
Carina surveyed the room. "I wouldn't mind some insurance, however. As you can see, Ali's place doesn't attract the finest clientele." The corporal grinned. He poked his head out the door and gave a wave. Four Marines piled into the room and took up positions along the walls. Ali held aside the grubby curtains, opened a metal door, and ushered Carina into a room bright with electric lights. A generator purred in another part of the building. Richly colored rugs covered the floor and walls. A television screen connected to an exterior security camera showed images of the street outside the building. The Humvee was clearly visible. Ali gestured for Carina to take a seat on a platform piled with large velvet cushions. He offered her tea, which she refused. He poured a glass for himself.
"What brings you out for a visit in the middle of an invasion?"
She met his question with a hard gaze.
"I came from the National Museum. It's been looted of thousands of antiquities."
He lowered his glass in mid-sip.
"That's outrageous. The National Museum is the heart and soul of Iraq's cultural heritage."
Carina laughed out loud at Ali's feigned shock.
"You should have been an actor, Ali. You'd easily win an Academy Award on that line alone."
Ali had learned his acting skills as a professional wrestler. He had even wrestled in the United States under the name of Ali Babas.
"How could you think I'd be involved in a heist like that?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.